It's been a long road getting from there to here. It's been a long time.
Welcome to Side Friction. Toss me my tickets, Ralph. The sci-fi comedy game show where comedians earn points for their opinions and how close those opinions are to my opinions.
Wait, is that an official new subtitle?
Huh?
Science Friction: Toss Me My Tickets, Ralph.
Yes, that's why he's got to be here every episode.
We're only doing one episode.
All right.
I love that. Look, it took. I had to move heaven and earth to get you both on this episode.
It's true.
It took so many texts, but you know what? I needed people who I could really get down in this Star Wars business with. First off, from Star Wars Minute, we got Pete the Retailer. Say hi.
Hello. Woo. Star Wars is my business.
Also, frequent contributor to Star Wars Minute, frequent contributor to the TV show Cake Boss, it's Cake Boss Ralph. Say hi.
Woo.
Cake Boss Ralph.
Say hi.
It's too late. For Christmas.
Cake Boss Ralph, say hi.
Hi.
I'm going to edit that out. For Christmas, you got a giant breastplate of armor. You got like half a suit of armor for Christmas. True or false?
That is true.
Tell us about the armor. Paint a picture in people's minds.
What a strange thing to want to know about. Yeah, so...
Oh, yes! What a strange thing to want to know about. A guy getting a cool suit of armor for Christmas.
I was just using that as a vocalized pause to collect my thoughts. Thanks for...
We'll start collecting.
Making it weird.
We'll start spitting them out. Go.
Yeah, no, I got a steel cuirass with matching pauldrons and like a bronze-toned skull helmet.
That skull helmet is cool.
I'm really excited about fucking some nerds up in it.
you have a LARPing girlfriend.
Yes, I am a LARP man. I do grown-up play pretend out in the woods.
And look, I've seen her. Very attractive lady.
Don't look
You're living the nerd dream. You got a LARPing girlfriend. You got your parents bought you a skull helmet for Christmas.
My parents really get me.
You could raise the visor and then say hi and then lower it and then there's just a skull there.
I like I like that you had say hi, where it's like you come out into the field of battle like clanking covered in armor and then raise up your imposing skull helmet and go, "Oh, hey guys, did you want to do sword fights? Because I'm down."
I hope you guys are here for sword fights.
I dressed for it.
Yeah.
Could you hide your head in the giant suit of armor much like a turtle? Ooh. Yes or no?
I think with a little finagling, yeah.
That's cool, man.
It's a lot bigger than my toast rack chest and beer gut really occupy.
You know what? You may call that a beer gut. That's like a pony keg.
Oh, hang
you
on.
You do not have a beer gut, buddy. Look good.
The friends at home can't see this, but I'm just going to... I generally just suck it in if I'm wearing a t-shirt, but here we go. Let's let it occupy the space it wants to.
Oh. Man, I'm going to suck it in because you're letting it out. Oh!
There's not enough room in here for everybody to be letting it out at the same time, so I'll do a half suck.
Okay.
I think if we all half suck, this will be a slightly better episode of Science Friction than usual.
No, there's no such thing. They're all the best. Pete.
Hello.
What did you get for Christmas that's nerdy? Or, if the answer is nothing, that's just nice.
My father-in-law got me the... how's this for a segue? My father-in-law got me the visual dictionary for the new Star Wars film, The Last Jedi.
Oh, how is it?
But it didn't arrive yet. So he gave me a picture of that. Saying this will be here soon, so I'm anxious to look into it because there's a lot of interesting little snippets and things.
I hear that we find out from the visual dictionary that Poe Dameron is where he wears a wedding ring around his neck that he's waiting to give to the right, not woman, person.
Oh. It's his mom's ring, right? It's from the comic book or whatever that came out.
Exactly.
Yeah, that's nice.
And he's waiting to give it to the right person. The Star Wars Visual Dictionary is not taking a firm stance on Poe Dameron's sexuality.
Well, you don't...
Unlike most of the internet, which is, and that firm stance is, He's a gay guy who likes boys. Mm.
I almost wore my Storm Pilot sock pair, but instead I'm just wearing Stormtrooper socks. So.
Storm Pilot?
That's the Poe Finn shipping. I'm
not wearing Star Wars socks, but I am wearing my Bebop and Rocksteady socks. I call them my Bebop and Socksteadies.
Nice! Wait! You get 5 tickets for those socks!
Oh.
Here you go. Wait.
I have Stormtrooper socks on.
Okay, you get 3 tickets.
Flametrooper socks.
One's
best
a Flametrooper
and
one's a Stormtrooper. So, hey, there we go.
Flametrooper.
Does Stance sponsor your show by any chance?
What?
Stance? Are they a sponsor?
No, they sponsor your show. You give out the code.
They used to. I haven't heard it in a while.
You give out your Stance code now.
I don't know if we have a current code.
Yeah, I don't know.
Stance.com/Star Wars.
Well, what are they going to do? Minute? Disable it?
I don't know.
That would take more effort
than
they
do sometimes.
Wait, really?
Also, I need to qualify that best trooper thing because I said the flame troopers are the best troopers, and I have to qualify that. They're the best post-original trilogy troopers.
Okay.
I really, really like the Imperial tank troopers from Rogue One.
Oh, yeah.
They have the best look of all of the, like, OT time setting.
Right. Oh, good stuff.
Really compelling shit for the audience at home.
They're
loving this.
This is why I'm anxious to see the visual dictionary, because it's full of all stuff like this. Nerdy
little
snippets.
But I got a question, as long as we're talking about trooper armor.
Yes?
How come they're not all wearing Captain Phasma's armor?
What the hell does Stormtrooper armor do? Because it doesn't stop blaster bolts, and everybody's wearing it, and it's armor. Like, is it just to protect your shins from coffee tables? It's... Jyn Erso takes them out with a stick, and she's not even the stick fighting guy in that movie.
No. That's another 5 tickets. Here you go.
What did I do?
I don't even remember. You have 5 tickets, too. Look! Captain Phasma's armor is deflecting blaster bolts left and right.
Or one from the front.
But it left and right! Here's the thing, if you shot her from the left, it would reflect to the right. If you shot her from the right, it would have deflected from the left.
You don't know that.
See, it's...
I have a pretty good idea!
I think it's special, you know, they can't afford to give that to everybody. It's like special, isn't it like Naboobian, like, it's made out of like a, like... Basically, Queen Amidala's ship, more or less.
Yes.
Is it made
because if there's one thing.
Is it made of Hessian smelt?
If there's 5 more tickets, nice reference. Because if there's one thing that the First Order doesn't seem to have, it's unlimited resources.
That's true.
Come on! They turned the planet into a Death Star. They can't make more than one suit of this stuff.
Terrence, do you think that's what. Do you think the First Order's budget is what the song Step Right Up, the Tom Waits song off Small Change, is that what that's about?
Let's hear a little
bit
of that song.
It turns a sandwich into a Death Star,
tickets.
Or a planet into a Death Star. Step right up and boom, 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 boom. That one, you know the one.
I think that was the theme
change
from Fraggle
Rock. Change your life, change it to a 9-year-old Hindu boy, get rid of your wife.
That was, well, you'll get 5 tickets, but I don't see the connection to Star Wars.
Yeah, you would if you
when you walk through the Mos Eisley, you better watch your back. Here comes Bossick and Dengar, and they're all of the attack.
You got to get behind the Rantu.
Yes! Yeah. When you follow the Jedi. All right, our first game. It's called Pedant Off.
Ooh.
Pedant Off.
That's like a spray, right?
Yes, no, exactly.
You really, you have
sort of Star Wars nerds.
Yeah.
Now, a lot of people.
You have the right 2 guests for this one.
I know I do. I moved heaven and earth to get you both here.
If there's going to be couldn't think of a joke that combines condescending and avuncular, but...
I can think of it. His name is Cake Boss Ralph. Now, here's what we're going to do. There's a lot of conversations that we can't have with our friends and family. Mm-hmm. Now's the time we're going to get it off. I want the most pedantic possible complaints about The Last Jedi. The more pedantic, the more tickets you get. Now I'm going to start off with a simple one.
Mm-hmm.
What, they don't have autopilot in the future? What the fuck? Mm. They've got these fucking little robots. They have astromech droids. They have droids that are specifically designed to, like, fix your ship. They can't pilot your ship. Every single ship in the Resistance fleet has to be piloted by... some minority who's like, come on, guys.
Well, to be fair, screaming and exploding minorities is a Star Wars trope ever since Return of the Jedi. So
it sure is.
They brought that back. They're like, oh, let's, you know, look, we got plenty of, you know, women and people of color. Look, they're exploding in the sky right as we speak.
I like how they. I like how in the first Star Wars movie it was like old white guys and fat white guys. Mm-hmm. They're gonna bite the bullet. Hey, actually, speaking of white guys, where the fuck is Wedge Antilles for all of this? They're bringing back Admiral Backbar. They're bringing back Nia Nub.
Admiral Backbar. That's because he came back.
Exactly. Well, not for long.
Admiral.
Where's
Snackbar.
Wedge Antilles? This guy blew up two Death Stars. I mean, the first one he got the assist. But right. Still, a lot of people didn't.
Yeah, no, an assist, you know, it counts for a point, assist.
I really wish that they had done, if they were going to do a Wedge Antilles movie set in, like, the time period of the original trilogy.
Yeah.
Clark Gregg.
Yes!
Clark Gregg.
Agent Coulson from the Marvel movies.
Okay.
That's good.
I can see it.
Put him in that role.
Now we've got four actors playing Wedge Antilles. That's great.
Who gives a fucking tauntaun's dick? I am in the theater for the Clark Gregg Wedge Antilles movie. I love Wedge.
I think we already had four, didn't we? No, we had three. You had fake Wedge, then you had Wedge's voice.
Right.
Then you
had
Dennis Lawson.
You have
okay,
proper
so you
Wedge.
Had three. I thought there was a fourth Wedge for some reason.
Right?
I could be wrong.
Look, you're Mr. Star Wars.
Hey, that's what it says on my business card.
Well, I went over to the crafty table and I had a sand wedge.
Delicious. Open face sand wedge.
I love it! Five tickets! Take five tickets! Pete the retailer!
It hit the symbol.
All right. Now that's my pedantic. Look, I could go real pedantic. What do you guys got? Get pedantic.
You know,
go.
Just because you said Pete the retailer just now, this doesn't have to do with what you're talking about, but Pete is saved in my phone as though he was a droid, and it's P-3TLR.
Hmm.
Oh, that's nice.
That is nice.
Yeah.
That should be my droid name.
I tried to do one for Alex where it was like LX, but there's no way to do Robinson, so I gave up, and also I don't have his number, so who cares?
I think that's Alex's canonical planet is LX. Robin-Sun or something like that.
Oh, that's, really?
Yeah.
That's interesting because I got a base that's just named Asterios.
Yeah.
No funny business with Kokonos. And by the way, listeners, if you didn't know that I was a canonical part of the Star Wars universe, you look it up in Wikipedia. I'm right there, baby.
I'm a canonical part of the MCU.
Tell me more.
Cake Boss gets specifically name dropped in an episode of Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. when they're like, where's what's his face? It's like, if I know him, he's watching the Cake Boss marathon back at home, which means that I exist in the MCU.
There you go.
Wait, but you weren't added to Cake Boss until season 4, right?
3, but.
Okay, so.
Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. didn't come on until like season 6 or 7.
But we don't know what year Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. takes place in. They have a completely different precedent.
If they're doing a marathon, it's not just going to be 2 seasons. It's got to be more than that. So therefore, Ralph's got to be in some of it.
All right, Ralph, you get 5 tickets, but I'm just saying there may at some point in the MCU be a divergent timeline where instead of Ralph joining the cast, someone else did. We don't know!
The point is, we're all owned by Disney.
Yeah. Oh my God, that's right.
It's bought and sold us body and soul.
They own our, you know, Asterios is copyright Disney right now because it's a canonical Star Wars thing.
Worth it.
Pete the Italia, copyright Disney because it's a canonical Star Wars thing.
You're in the, tell me who you are in the Star Wars universe.
I am a woman of color. I'm a resistance tech officer. Who's
tech officer?
Exactly,
tech officer.
She's she kind of keeps she fixes up BB-8 a little bit in between some of Poe's missions, and it's a good. She's got a little romantic story in a back issue. What's the
backup story
in one of the Poe Dameron comics?
I've read that. I liked it. I didn't know that was you. All right, you guys aren't getting pedantic enough. I'm going around for another pass. I had a pedantry
if you want to get into it.
We'll bring it out.
Here. I'm sure this has been brought up before, but...
It doesn't matter!
Now, I'm willing to overlook the time discrepancy with Rey's story and the main story with the Resistance fighters and the fleet. I can forgive it being like... Because she's on Act 2, God bless me, for easily 4 days in the movie. So it could be that she got there 4 days before... the events of, like, this slow-speed space chase start. Except that Kylo Ren's facial scar is healed when she's talking to him via the Force. But and that doesn't happen until after that space chase starts.
That's right, because we see the robot fixing his face.
Right, we fucking see it in the movie, like it's on screen. And so like if they didn't do that, it all could have worked out. But no, they specifically say it's 16 hours worth of fuel that they have while Rose Psycho and Finn, no last name, go to Canto Bite.
That's his last name.
To pick up the Master Code Breaker.
Right.
You hear that? You hear that?
They got
noise?
16 hours to get there and back, but she's on Act Two for 4 days. I also like that the middle movie of the three movie trilogy is called Act Two.
Largely on Act
Two.
Yeah.
So
you hear all that noise? You hear that ticket ripping sound? That's me pulling 20 tickets off the roll. I have yet to hear that.
Just making up numbers.
That is some very. That's pedantic, buddy.
Yeah.
Really good job. And also, Pete, 5 tickets for remembering Finn's stormtrooper designation.
Well, it's 2187. Go now.
I'm proud of you.
Thank you.
Good job.
I'm also
2186 was his buddy that bit it, right?
I think he had a weird other number. Well, one of his buddies has been non-canonically referred to as TR-8R.
Yeah, right. But that's not.
Because he's the one that shows up and says, traitor! And,
oh! What?
Yeah. That guy has a canonical number, which I can't remember now, because there's a story they do like hand-to-hand combat training.
Right. They're like training buddies.
Oh, man.
It's like Stripes, but not different.
People are losing their minds over this episode. This is comedy.
I am so happy. This is what I've been looking forward to more than anything. I haven't had one Star Wars buddy to just unload about all this with. I'm glad you guys are my friends. Get pedantic, Pete, go!
Why is it that they can take all kinds of ships to casino planets and whatever else, but then they can't just go pick up some, like, hyperspace gas? Like, why can't they just send a ship out, like a shuttle out, to go pick up some fuel?
5 tickets! 10 tickets! 15 tickets! They 15 tickets to beat the retailer!
You're right!
Or come back with go hyperspace out to the casino and be like, hey, somebody, get a bigger ship and come back and do a whole thing.
Or just send everyone to the casino, one shuttle at a time!
For that matter, if the First Order is, they don't have the same fuel constraints that the Radis, which is named for Winston Churchill from Rogue One.
Right.
They don't have the fuel constraints that the Radis has in this space chase. Why don't they just do a very, like, take the time and be like, listen, everybody get out your slide rule and your pencil and your big eraser, the one that says for really big mistakes and has the shrugging stormtrooper on it.
That's right.
Like, get that shit out and figure out a hyperspace jump to, like, 20 feet in front of the other ship and just be like, oh, guess what, Resistance, we're in front of you now. You divert all power to rear shields, we're gonna blow you up.
Or call your friends and tell them, hey, we're going in a straight line, like, so just go like,
you know, all the rest of those arrowhead shaped ships that we have, can you send as few as one of them here but 30 feet ahead of us? Thanks, bro.
That's another 10 tickets, Ralph. I thought the same thing. I'm like, you're in space. Use all three dimensions. It seems like everyone in Star Wars only ever uses
two dimensions. They think it's a car chase.
Yeah. I know. Which, to be fair, George Lucas, car chases.
But he's not in this movie.
But he's not. But, you know, a lot of the Lucas rules stay.
Yeah. But, what's his face? George Lucas isn't in it, but the director of Monsters and Gareth Edwards is.
Right. He's the guy who tastes the planet.
No, he's the guy right next to him. Oh, the guy's like, salt. And the guy who looks at him and correctly goes, why are you saying that with his body language? It's Gareth Edwards. Hmm. I had another I can't remember now. There was a big, dumb thing.
Mr. Jennifer Aniston.
Justin Theroux's in the movie?
He's the Master Codebreaker.
It's very convenient that the person locked up in jail with is the other person who can do what they need, isn't it?
Yes. I thought that they were going to do this. That it was gonna be that Benicio del Toro sold his medal for some chips, and they were gonna do a thing where it's like, oh, I gotta get my medal back, and
Either that, or like he was gonna adjust the lapel of his jacket, and you'd see the plum bloom under there, and you're like, oh, he's the guy, not the rich guy.
Right.
But also, no, it was just by chance the hobo in our cell is the right guy.
Why? Like, there's a whole discussion about this, and I've seen Rian Johnson defended it, and I understand, but like, if you're going to a casino planet, why not have Lando? Like, that's the whole thing. He defended it by saying, like, well, we couldn't have Lando be the Benicio del Toro character because he would be He's already betrayed the rebellion once, and Lando's a good guy now, and we don't want to kind of have him dick everybody over again.
It would make the universe so fucking small. The only way you could do it and for it not to suck would have him be, have Lando be the guy that they were supposed to meet.
Right.
Who's rolling at the high stakes table.
Right.
But then they wind up with Benicio Del Toro instead, but then every fan would be even angrier.
Right. I know, because we want Lando, we're not getting Lando.
But, like, there are more than these six people in the universe.
Not in Star Wars.
Well, increasingly, it's blowing it out so it is less so. Like, that's one of the things that I loved about it is that, you know, like, this movie specifically diffused all of the, like, oh, like, who's Snoke? It's somebody we've met before. Like, that doesn't matter. He's dead now. Like,
I'm
Ray's parents. Who are they? Oh, nobody. Like, great. Yeah. That's, like, that's all good stuff. It's all making it, great. Yeah.
No, he's getting five tickets for that. He's not getting more.
You give him more.
No, because the thing is, that's not pedantic. That's just intelligent.
No, yeah, it's not.
It's like we're all glad that Rey is not a Kenobi, and we're all glad that Snoke is just some asshole. Because if he was like a clone of the Emperor or some shit, it'd be like, okay, all right.
But keep in mind, J.J. Abrams is getting this back.
I know he's going to trump all of this Obama shit.
Oh. That was, Snoke was just planting because Snoke did say that he connected Rey and Kylo Ren's minds, and that's when
he three-way called them.
Right. And silently just sat there and like, but since he was doing that, he could have also, like, he gave them the visions that brought them together, so he could have also just implanted the visions in their mind, like, oh, your parents are nobody, to kind of help dissuade her from researching further into it, and it could all be fake. She could actually discover that then her parents are somebody that we already know.
Yeah, I just don't want another what I told you was true from a certain point of view bullshit. Right. It really, like, when I think about J.J. Abrams doing the next movie, I just feel like it's like when you get a new president, he's like, I don't like what the old president did, and I'm going to change all of it because I can now.
Right.
I don't want to get political.
That's not what normally happens. Like, what normally happens is, like, Obama's like, well, look, I don't like that the last president did it, but that was a settled election, blah, blah, blah. Like, we don't usually get, like, a president who's just like, delete everything, delete, delete. Like, this is a funny president we got
I like
now.
Your broken Donald Trump thing.
Yeah, I like it. Your Trump is essentially a Dalek.
Yes, exactly. Delete, delete. Fox and Friends, watch Fox and Friends. I didn't watch any pee-pee. God. No, I don't want to get into the pee-pee tape.
Okay.
I'll talk about the pee-pee tape all day.
Pee-pee tape was one of the new droids, right?
Yes.
Yes. Yeah. Okay. I'm going to get pedantic about these droids.
Sure. I want you to have a shirt that says that. I'm going to get pedantic about these droids.
I would love to. Five tickets to that shirt. What? BB-8? Look, if BB-8 can tie up three guards and also gag their mouths, and if BB-8 can take over an AT-ST, and if BB-8 can fix a starfighter, why don't they just have a whole fleet of BB-8s?
Mm.
Like, if BB-8 is the best and can literally murder stormtroopers, why are you sending out humans? You send five BB-8s, they'll defeat the whole First Order.
I would love to see that battle where they just, like, come up, there's, like, you see a whole bunch of stormtroopers lining up, and then somebody just comes out with, like, a box full of BB-8s, like, and just dumps them out, and it's just like, blah, blah, blah.
You get to have that classic henchman bad guy moment, too, where, like, all the First Order troopers are all standing there, weapons drawn, and just, like, five little robots come out of a box. They're like, but sir, it's just five robots. What could five robots possibly do? That's classic shit.
Yes, it is. And they're like, ah, ha, ha, look at them. Look at those little ball droids. They're not even like canister droids like the R2-D2 is or R5-D4. They're not even like gonk droids. Yeah, fuck them. They're worse than mouse droids. And all of a sudden, they all get killed. I'm telling you guys, BB-8, in the Force Awakens, he's afraid to go down the stairs. Now in this movie, he's taking over AT-STs and shooting Captain Phasma's troops. Too strong. Am I wrong?
He is the real Mary Sue of this movie.
Yes, five tickets. I'm running out of tickets. This is so good.
I did not like that part, so I won't defend it. There's some things I definitely like. Some things about that BB-8. Like, I liked coming and not seeing it. I like coming around the corner and all of a sudden there's just like a bunch of guys beaten up and tied up and BB-8's there and he's just like, did you do this? And not seeing it makes it a good gag, but then they had to overdo it and he shoots them with the coins, and then later I really don't like the AT-ST thing. Because it starts out okay, and then it's just like, oh, it just happens to rip off his head, so you can see, like, hello there, I'm BB-8.
Yes, it's very convenient. Also, that scene feels like in Mortal Kombat. Not Mortal Kombat, Street Fighter.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Because it's there's when Finn is fighting Phasma, right? And you see the two of them just fighting across, like, one plane. And behind them, there is all kinds of crazy hell and chaos going on. Mm. Like, BB-8 shooting, you know, walker lasers at all the stormtroopers. And it's just, like, the weird animation that plays in the background of a Street Fighter fight. Where, like, there are two characters really going at it back and forth across the screen. And there's just shit happening behind them.
There's elephants and all kinds of people. No, that's an actual level where you're punching a car, right?
Yeah, but there's no one cheering for you then. But when Gao's fighting on the deck of a goddamn aircraft carrier, there's people cheering left and right. No matter who's winning or what's happening, they're just cheering for violence.
Yeah, they just like good violence.
It's and also, who can blame them?
I'm
like
just here
too.
For good baseball.
It's really stretching the definition of a street fight if it's on an aircraft carrier.
Five more tickets to Ralph! I feel like you get one. You get one BB-8 rescues everybody moment.
Right.
You get one. I don't think you get two. If BB-8 had been pretty useless for everything, and then at the end he's in an AT-ST, I'm like, okay, you've earned it.
Right.
But like, come on. Also, he ties up three guys, and then his plan for the fourth guy is shoot him with coins. Come on. Where'd all your guile and gusto go, BB-8?
Well, guile's on the aircraft carrier.
Yes.
Yeah, and gusto is an unlockable character in the DLC.
No, gusto is the weird artist gummy bear who lived behind the waterfall.
Wait, is it really?
Is he accurate?
That's Augustus gummy.
Oh,
wow.
Okay, you get five reluctant tickets.
That's three.
I've overpaid you several times.
I'm throwing Ralph some tickets for a gummy bears reference.
I guess I'll do a little dance.
There's tickets here and there and everywhere. This is a ridiculous studio. Okay, last licks for pedanticness before we go to our next game. Come on, guys.
Okay.
I had one, but I lost it.
Really get it all? Is it about hyperspace and how? Come on.
No.
Really?
I mean, it does break space combat in the Star Wars movies from here forward, because
completely.
All you need is an inert, like, solid object with a hyperdrive attached to it, and you can fuck an Imperial fleet to death, or First Order fleet to death, any fleet to death.
Apparently. Mm. It's just like, just get a bunch of dumb... I mean, again, there's no autopilot, so I guess you're sending these people on suicide missions, but just put one guy in a Corellian Corvette, throw him at the Executor.
Okay.
Oh, no, go ahead.
Pete's gotta defend it.
There probably had to be some kind of mass calculation there. So it couldn't have been just like a small thing. It had to be, you know, that was their big ship, their main cruiser that did some damage. And, you know, there's still like people walking around and saying like, oh no, like on... So it's not like it blew it to hell. It just kind of cut through it.
Because when you go into hyperspace...
It cut it in half, Pete!
Yeah, but when you were still people running around.
When you go into hyperspace, you drop out of regular space, right? Like you're not... Because there are plenty of times when they go into hyperspace, if there was a ship in front of you, you wouldn't hit it. She had to have done some weird jiggery-pokery to be like, I'm engaging this hyperspace drive, but not all the way. Or so, like, getting that initial thrust, but not too... Like,
she
that
was like in
that
super
was
space,
smart
not hyperspace.
Piloting.
Well, you have to work your way up to it and maybe, you know, plotting a course that, it, like, start it right before you get
like
there.
Yeah, like, dropped
so
into and immediately
in
dropped
space.
Out of or something... I don't know.
See, when they were fucking around with hyperspace in The Force Awakens, which, by the way, I think is a better movie than The Last Jedi.
I disagree strongly.
Okay, and I guess we'll talk about that in the next round.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But, like, I like that Han Solo was like, well, we'll come out of hyperspace inside the shield. I'm like, that's pretty smart. Like, why would you come out of hyperspace in orbit? If you could come out of hyperspace within a thing? Because even Han Solo's like, yeah, this might kill us. But it's like, you know... You do a lot of stuff that might kill you, Han Solo, and it almost always works out except for that last time. When they go into hyperspace in the docking bay, I'm thinking to myself, well, yeah, you don't need a runway. It's space. Your spaceship. But in this it gives me pause.
You need some runway, some space to get up to speed. Because they use hyperspace and light speed interchangeably, so you need to get up to speed. You can't just be like, whoa, it's like 0 to 60.
But the Millennium Falcon takes off. That's how they escape from Conja Club.
Right.
Remember, it just like hovers up and takes off inside the.
I bet it wrecked that ship doing that, though. Like, the
I
ship
know,
was in.
But that's why I didn't say it was a consequenceless. I'm just saying that's a cool tactical way to use hyperspace.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So, Pete, I wanted to run this by you. Like, how many of the things in this movie could have been solved by, like, mundane 21st century technology?
Mm.
Like, when she's like, Snoke killed the... When Kylo Ren's like, oh, the girl killed Snoke. And it's like, well, I guess they don't have security cameras in Snoke's throne room.
Right. Well, like, probably not. He seems like a paranoid leader of sort, so I'm sure he wouldn't have... You know, he have cameras everywhere else, but in his own place, he wouldn't have security cameras.
There's a weird thing with the level of technology in the Star Wars movies, though, right. where they're honestly more like a medieval sword and sorcery tale. I mean, just some things are replaced with you don't have horses or carriages or ships. You have spaceships, but basically, it's just people with hand weapons or ranged weapons in tunics and
armor.
Yeah, tunics and armor. Like they're you can make. Calls to other people, but like it's difficult. It's not like I could pull out my cell phone and just be like, "Oh shit, there's too much guys wearing white armor. Don't come here." Like,
right? There's no texting in the Star Wars universe.
Yeah, there's no text, there's no email. No,
yes,
you know, like you could have just downloaded all the Death Star uploaded the Death Star specs to like a server somewhere, but no, you have to deliver them.
Mm-hmm.
Right? You can.
It's a very low
a hologram of yourself. But you have to then put that hologram onto a droid.
It's very low-tech, high-tech.
Yeah. Right.
There's a lot of...
And you can call people while they're in hyperspace and talk to each other.
But you can't track them through hyperspace.
We've got to
Now you can track them, yeah.
You're getting 5 more tickets because I think we're on to our final pedantic thing, which is...
Are we still on the first category?
Because we have to talk... Because they call Maz Kanata from hyperspace, and the Empire, can't intercept that. It wasn't on a code.
Well, that would be rude.
What?
But you know who's super rude?
Super
General
rude.
Hux. He's about to murder a guy on the ground.
That's one of the best moments in the movie.
I honestly...
Hux is fantastic in this, in general.
I've loved Hux from the beginning. When he almost kills Kylo Ren, I was so happy. I'm like, yeah, you little worm, I love it. I can't wait to see how they kill your character off. That's the thing I like about... Look, I've said it before, I'll say it again. The thing I like about these new movies is that you really want the bad guys to lose. Emperor Palpatine is pretty cool.
Oh, he's lovely!
He's funny. He's, like, smart. He's got a goal that he achieves.
He looks like an albino scrotum.
What? Huh?
Oh, he looks like an albino scrotum peeking out of a black bathrobe.
But with those beautiful, piercing eyes.
Yeah, I love him.
Yeah, exactly. And the first time you see him, he's shooting lightning out of his hands. Now we're used to it. But at the time, that was... Remember when he started shooting lightning and you're like, oh, God, Luke's definitely going to die.
That was if I can step back into the Last Jedi for a second. Yoda calling down lightning was an interesting new... there's a lot of new Force powers, but Yoda calling down lightning, I was a little bit like, oh, okay. Like Force Ghost Yoda calling down, not even like physical Yoda.
I'm okay with that, though, because he's not offensively shooting lightning from himself. Like,
right.
He's now sort of at one with the whole, like, warp and weave of the universe and everything. And that's, like, a simple elemental force that, you know, like, that to me works. He's like, I need to make a point. And since I'm basically, I know I'm a little puppet sitting here, but I'm also those clouds. I'm also the space between the molecules and that clouds. I'm all of that.
Right.
So I can make a little bit of lightning happen here.
Right. Yeah, It gave me pause, but I like that explanation.
Just like gloves that look like a bear's hands.
It gives you pause.
Yeah.
Five.
After a brief pause, I got that.
Now, I didn't even connect the whole lightning thing with Yoda, where he's called on the lightning. Because that, to me, is part of Yoda's funny, goofy power set.
Right.
Where it's like, oh, I'm going to lift up an X-Wing, but... Only to show you you're an asshole.
So he has like Roger Rabbit rules for his force usage?
Yes. Right.
Only if it's funny. Ralph.
Yeah.
Exactly. When it's appropriate, he can do it.
Did you notice that? So I keep cutting you off. I'm the worst.
Ralph, you're not talking enough. Talk to me.
So one of the things that I liked, I hated in the prequel trilogy how they sort of made the Force really boring to me.
Mm-hmm.
It's like there's a regimented...
They made a lot of things really boring in the prequel
trilogy.
They sure
did.
Yep. They made Samuel L. Jackson boring somehow.
Yeah. It became very regimented. They're like, you can do this and this, but you can't do this. And like, these are the Force powers.
Yes.
And then this movie made the Force like... mysterious and spiritual and cool again?
Yes.
Where the hell was I going with this? What were we talking about? Oh, but so when Rey is talking about what she sees of the Force when Luke is, which is the best scene of the movie.
It's really good.
It made the Force work for me again. Mm-hmm. And this movie is really pushing that, like, light and dark, like, those things are, the Jedi and the Sith are not what the Force is about. The Force is about this balance, and it sort of makes a lot of the bullshit from the prequels a little more palatable to me, because it's not defeating the Sith that brings balance to the Force. It's that the Force is about balance. And one of the weird little subtle things I liked is that the light side of the Force on this island is a penis, and the dark side of the Force on that island is a vagina.
I believe it's pronounced vagina.
Oh, sorry, vagina.
Thank you.
But yeah, it's because the light side is a tree and the dark side is like a hairy hole.
Yep.
Mm. Interesting.
Also, you gotta say to yourself, pretty subtle. Pretty subtle there, Rian Johnson. So the good guy thing is a tree with some books in it.
No, you've misunderstood.
And the bad guy thing is a scary dark hole where you find your mirror clones.
No. You've misunderstood entirely. It's not a good guy, bad guy thing. He keeps saying, like he says, to say that the light belongs to the Jedi is vanity. And that, you know, the time for both of the character, Luke and Kylo Ren are both like, no, this Jedi Sith thing has to end. Throw it away. Get rid of it. Stop it. He's saying it's not like, oh, vaginas are bad and dicks are good. It's that they're both part.
Butts are also good.
They're. Oh, Pete, you beautiful man.
5 tickets to Pete.
They're both necessary for everything to work.
I disagree with that entirely. One side of people are electrocuting guys and slicing people in half, and the other side of people are making it so that no one can be in love and have sex.
You're missing
it
entirely.
Wait a minute, they're both bad.
That's what I said. That's just what I said.
But you didn't put it in my words.
Yeah, what they're saying is the Jedi and the Sith are both the wrong thing for the Force. You need both the light and the dark, but you don't need those groups of people.
One half puts you into a robot armor where you feel tortured your whole life. You gotta live on a lava planet attended to by weirdo guards. The other half doesn't take your mom out of slavery and take the bomb out of her brain. They're bad.
Thank you.
Both sides, both candidates are the same.
Exactly.
I'm gonna,
And I know you haven't.
Douche and turd.
I know you haven't gotten this far in episode 3 yet because you're only watching it 1 minute at a time, Pete.
Right.
But at the end of Return of the Shit, Obi-Wan leaves.
That totally sounds like a blaxploitation movie that I would watch.
The Return of the Shit.
Oh man, he's the shit.
He leaves his best friend with just a arm and a torso on fire next to a lake of fire. And instead of either putting him out of his misery or taking him with him and going, Anakin, we're going to get you fixed up, he just shakes his head like, wish there was something I could do, and walks away. Not a good guy.
That's his idea of, like, mercy.
He's like,
I can't kill him. Send me to kill the Emperor. I can't kill Anakin. And it's like, you seem to do a pretty good job. Like,
I like that maybe that's Michael Caine as Obi-Wan. That's a good one.
Wait, what?
I like your Michael Caine as Obi-Wan.
I can't kill him. Or Michael Caine can't kill him. You killed my brother.
Yeah, I'm anxious to get to that part. See what's up. Because I'm in a phase where Obi-Wan is my favorite Star Wars character, but he's been absent from the last 3 movies, so there's a lot of other characters kind of bubbling up, having fun, doing stuff, and I'm anxious to get some more Obi-Wan going on.
Yeah,
I think they're going to find a way to fix Obi-Wan Kenobi with the standalone Obi-Wan Kenobi movie. Mm. Which, come on, there's no way it's not Ewan McGregor. Who else are they going to cast as Obi-Wan Kenobi?
Oh, he really wants to do it.
He really wants to do it. The fans want it. I feel like they're just holding off on the announcement for, like, a boring year.
And
like, Kathy Kennedy is going to be like, Ewan McGregor's back.
And now here's a fun connection. Oh, go ahead.
Didn't they just make maybe it's not an announcement at all. I thought that came out recently.
Yeah,
they were like, no, really.
There's a lot of
talk
about it.
Yeah. Because I think as soon as they were like, as soon as they heard that Obi-Wan.
Yeah.
As soon as they heard that Obi-Wan wanted to do it.
Do you mean old Ben?
No, Obi-Wan. Ewan McGregor was like, yeah, I'd probably do that. And they were like, oh, really? Wait, hang on. What if we got you, like, Baz Luhrmann or whoever that, like, I forgot who they signed up, who they talked to be like, what if we got him? Would you do it? Like, so I think something's going to work out.
Look, the guy to Train Spotting 2. He'll do the goddamn Obi-Wan Kenobi movie.
So, fun story. Sure. Ewan McGregor, this isn't a story. Ewan McGregor plays Obi-Wan Kenobi, and Donald Gleason plays Armitage Hux.
Mm-hmm.
But Donald Gleason in the Peter Rabbit movie plays Farmer McGregor.
Oh.
Coincidence?
And Ewan McGregor plays Little Baby Hux.
Teddy Huxpin.
Exactly!
Oh, man.
Stick a cassette in him. He won't like it.
He's organic. Like Teddy Huxpin, like a teddy bear wearing like a First Order Imperial
and
officer.
And he's just really pissy about all the stories he tells you.
Totally.
He just screams you to sleep every night with his weird Nazi yelling.
Like, good night, Moon!
What? What?
And so the third Billy Goat Gruff defeated the troll, which was a travesty! The troll should have been victorious!
I love that Hux has performance mode Hux and then just regular whiny Hux. Because that's what an actor is. It's like you put an actor on stage and they're big, and then the moment they go on stage, you're like, "How was that good? Did you like it? I thought
like
I was okay."
Like a penis.
Oh.
Just like, exactly. When it's working, it's working, but when it's done, it's done. Okay, boys.
Plus, sorry, I just want to throw in Vivian from The Young Ones is Hux's first officer, which is fantastic.
What?
Yeah.
Well, they may not be The Young Ones very long. Well,
no, he looks very old in this, but... but yeah, Adrian Edmondson is like that. Like, I thought it was just a cameo because I read it after the fact. I was like, oh yeah, he was in that. And then I just saw the movie again and I was like, oh, he's in that a lot. Like, he's the first officer.
And that explains why in the middle of the movie, Madness comes out and just plays.
Yes! And they're all wearing Dr. Martin's boots.
Where'd he get that doctor from? You're wearing Doc Martin's right now.
I am.
You never look less like a doctor than when you're wearing Dr. Martens. Anyway.
Sometimes you look like a Martin, the little aquatic mammal.
Yes, exactly.
Those are trees.
You mean a marlin?
Are they tree mammals?
Yeah, marlins live in the ocean. Martins,
not a marlin.
Like a pine martin? Or, you know, like little weasels.
I thought they were water weasels.
Water weasels?
I think a lot of things are water weasels.
Water weasels is the name of our, like, goofy 90s ska band.
Let's pitch
it.
I was going to say it's our animated series.
Oh, yeah. We could sell the shit out of some water weasels.
Yeah. It's like that post-black and white boom Teenage Mutant Ninja Turtles, you know, Boris the Bear, adolescent radioactive black belt hamsters. Water weasels. It's totally... Let's pitch it right now.
Samurai Pizza Cats.
Right.
Wait. Let's all go around in a circle.
Preteen Dirty Jean Kung Fu Kangaroos.
There you go.
That's a good one. Biker Mice from Mars.
Mm.
Let's keep naming all of them until we run out of them.
Street Sharks, Snailians.
Yep. Ooh. Those Street Sharks. Jossum, 5 tickets.
I don't want the Street Shark tickets.
You got them.
Oh, God damn it.
Sorry.
Wait, do you have Battletoads?
Those are... No, they count.
They're radical. They wear sunglasses.
And they have a big bad boot. They do.
Mm.
The Battletoads, all I just think of is... how sad that game makes me because it's so difficult.
Mm.
I can't... It's like they just made a game to make you cry.
I have a question.
Sure.
Is there another category of this game?
Yeah. All right. Round two. The last and final round.
Wait, two? Okay.
I know. We were pedantic for a while.
Act two?
That was 44 minutes of pedantism.
Pedantry.
Pedantry, right. Thank you. 5 tickets. I'm almost out of tickets.
Actually.
All right, boys.
Yes.
Final game. Best and the worst. I want you to name your favorite thing about this new Star Wars movie and your least favorite thing about it. And if they match up with my favorite thing and my least favorite thing, you get a lot of tickets.
All right.
Now, you can think about it for a second. We have an editor. There's no need to rush.
If I'm trying to think of Asterios' favorite thing,
just give me yours. I already know mine.
No, because we're scored based on how close our opinions hew to your own and some weird narcissistic thing that you're doing.
Less weird, more narcissistic.
So if I had to guess what your favorite part is, I gotta think like some real SJW cuck snowflake thing.
That's right. Yep.
But that's also really sarcastic at the same time. Is there a...
Is it ironic or is it genuine? You don't know with me.
Yeah, I don't. And the weird thing is, like, on paper, your values line up with mine, but the delivery of the things you say makes me question if that's true.
That's exactly right. I'm like a dark mirror, much like the dark mirror that Rey looked in when she went in that hole.
And that was your favorite part!
No.
But I liked it.
Yeah, I didn't like it. It's fine.
It's a good build up and accusation, though. I liked it a lot. It was good. So that wasn't your favorite part?
No.
My favorite part, and it's not a specific, we can tie it to specific parts, but it's more of a theme.
Yeah.
Is that it was like that whole kind of let the past die kind of a thing.
Yes!
Culminating probably in the burning of the, like, where Yoda calls down the lightning and burns the tree, and it's just like, hey, stop worrying about whether or not all this bullshit is canon and just have fun and enjoy this space movie. And it was like, all the stuff about, like, look, stop connecting it all and making it, you know, just enjoy it. Here it is. And that's I felt like that was coming through in a lot of the other stuff, not just the Yoda thing, but also like,
well, Kylo Ren is literally like, let the past die, I'm gonna kill it with my laser sword,
right? And you know, specifically diffusing all the stuff that JJ set up with Snoke and with Rey's parents and all that, it was another good, just like, look, just roll with it, just here's a new thing, go. Nice. I like that part.
Yeah, I
like that part.
I like that too, the theme of like rebirth, renewal, letting the past, yeah. That was some really good stuff. That you got 5 tickets that I worked like in the middle of what you were saying, but here's another 5 tickets. Good job. Right.
So I hate to go back to that Yoda scene, but
sure.
I'm gonna. I think my very favorite, like, after, because I already said that I like the part when Rey is learning what the Force is or whatever.
It was really good.
Yeah, but I love when the very last shot of that Yoda scene, when he's sitting next to Luke and they're talking about, it's the curse of all mentors. We are what they grow beyond. And that's just, and the two of them just watching, you know, something unimportant burn down. And my least favorite part of the movie is literally every single other shot of Yoda.
What?
Because that puppet looks terrible.
It's hard to even...
And I love puppet Yoda.
Yeah.
But this particular puppet is real dodgy, man.
It's more like Jedi puppet Yoda than Empire puppet Yoda.
Thank you, Pete.
Like they went back and they redid it, but there's so much of making Yoda look good as lighting, and they didn't, like, you know, sitting on the rocks on a sunny planet is not the way to do it. Should have had him in a cave or something.
I also like the Porg that almost gets lightsabered through the eye socket.
Yes.
Yes!
That's a fantastic one.
Okay, you're getting 5 tickets for your first, the first thing you brought up about Yoda. And you're getting another reluctant 5 tickets. Look, I've been in denial.
I'm going to give you some puppets back.
That puppet did not look good. I've been saying to myself, hey, that was a good puppet, and the jankiness is made up for the fact that it's
a
ghost.
Hey, that was a good puppet.
But it's like, you know what? In my heart of hearts, how come they could only get Yoda right once?
I don't know.
Lighting. It's all about lighting.
But Octo, it's at night? It's like they could have made it misty and shit. They could have made it like Dagobah. We've had Empire Strikes Back Yoda, Return of the Jedi Yoda, Phantom Menace Yoda, Attack of the Clones Yoda. What's the other one? Revenge of the Sith Yoda. And now this Yoda. That's 1 out of 5.
Mm-hmm.
You know what? If C-3PO were here to calculate the odds, he'd say you got a 1 in 5 chance of getting a good Yoda. They got Frank Oz back.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Never tell me the Oz.
Whoa!
Victory Taylor! Okay. My least favorite thing about this movie, none of you guys got it right, was Finn and Poe, everything with Finn and Poe, except like the first time we see each character.
Mm-hmm.
The first time we see Poe,
he's
Craig Cullen from that X-Wing. Hilarious. I've heard a lot of people talk shit about that. I'm sorry. That was funny.
I loved it.
It's really funny to wind up Admiral Hux. It's like, that's great. And then his assistant is like, I believe he's pranking you, sir.
He's tooling.
Tooling.
Yeah.
Nobody says tooling. Where does that come from?
That was great. And then, like, after Poe shoots all the turbo lasers and they bomb her the thing, like, the admiral that was in the dreadnought going, like, oh, bother, dude, before he dies.
The commander of that dreadnought.
Yes.
Has taken the recipient of the Grand Moff Tarkin Unlikely Favorite Character Award for this movie because he's fantastic.
Every twitch of his jowls was like a masterclass.
Yeah, it's like, we can't get him with the cannons. We need to scramble our fighters. 5 bloody minutes ago. He's just so British and pissy about the whole thing, and I love them.
No. This is pretty much everybody in the First Order I love. And it goes back to, you know, continuing my thing with Imperial officers. Like, First Order, they keep doing the same thing. They're fantastic bad guys.
I like how the First Order, like, rank and file are much more aware of the fact that they work for fucking maniacs than the Empire was. Like, the Stormtroopers, I feel like, are big Darth Vader fanboys.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like, and if he showed up, he was like, you guys are the total fucking shit. They would all lose their minds. But if Kylo Ren stood up in front of all of them and was just like, I grudgingly admit that you're doing a good job, everyone there would just be like almost pissing their pants going, I really hope he doesn't kill all of us.
Yeah. It's, you know, it's what? True. That's another five chicken. It's a very good point. There's a lot of, like,
those almost landed in the garbage.
It's where all
That's
of them
not
are
where
going.
They belong. Hmm. They belong amongst the stars.
Do I get to trade these in for, like, those rubber finger puppets of, like, the monsters with the woogity arms?
Honestly, I did bring two prizes, and you will get to trade in your tickets.
All right.
Oh. I do love all the reaction shots. Because even in The Force Awakens, like, those stormtroopers, when Kylo Ren is throwing his little shit fit with his lightsaber, they're just like, exit stage right! That's hilarious! I love it!
Wait, isn't that somebody? All the stormtroopers are somebody.
That
now,
was Daniel
right?
Craig.
Oh, okay.
Daniel Craig
is the one, yeah.
But I think that was somebody else. So the two stormtroopers who turn around was.
Wasn't one of them the director
people.
Of Baby Driver?
Oh, it could be, yeah.
I thought Adam it was Driver? One of them was a famous director. My favorite thing about The Last Jedi is Luke Skywalker.
Hmm.
I think.
Oh, he's so fucking good. How did we miss this?
He's the best. He's so great. When he's like, I'm not going to train you. I'm not doing shit with you. I'm going to milk a big pig and stab a fish. Fuck you. I'm kind of like, you know what? I don't even know why you don't want to train this girl, but I'm on your side. She is being annoying. Even though she was not being annoying, she brought back his laser sword.
Which he said, I love it, of course, in my heart. Like, when he said, what do you think? I'm just going to show up with a laser sword and defeat the First Order? And I was like, laser sword.
Yes! Yeah. I love that he said laser sword. That is clearly someone who has watched the red letter media. Like,
it's the most dismissive way you can talk about a lightsaber.
Yes!
Perfect.
Which is how George Lucas always refers to them as. So he's wonderfully dismissive of his own stuff.
Yeah, but George Lucas
pull
is
out that little laser sword and Dr. Chow.
That's from the behind the scenes from episode 2.
Yes.
Nice.
George Lucas is essentially the weird beach pig.
Yes! That's another five ticket!
Like, it's just, Mark Hamill just comes back to that thing once every 30 years and, like, just squirts some more career out of it into a bottle. That, oh, this sounds real. I love Mark Hamill. I want to take all of that back. Zwick, edit that out.
That's fine. Yeah, Zwick, edit that out.
No, don't.
I like that we find out where blue milk comes from, and it comes
That's
from
green
a weird
milk.
Big space.
Yeah,
what?
It's different milk.
Different milk.
Oh, I saw it in a shitty theater.
Mm.
It looked blue to me. I believe you both that it's green.
It's kind of blue-green.
I'm not here to argue.
But kind of like Pert Plus. Or, no.
It looked like Celsin Blue to me.
Celsin Blue. There
but you to
go.
You, it looked like Celsin Green.
Oh, yeah.
Okay, fair
Isn't
enough.
Isn't Celsin Green people?
All right, enough of this. I'm about to lose the studio. I only ran in for 2 hours. Tally up your tickets, boys. They're all over the floor. Count up your tickets. Split these ones in the middle.
Okay, I watched this very carefully.
This one is mine and this one's yours.
Yeah, all the ones by the drum centerpiece.
I don't feel like I deserve this giant strip for what I did.
That's fine. It was great. Don't start with me.
Somebody here.
They are literally crawling all over the floor of the studio because what you can't see is when
tickets.
I award people tickets, I just throw them at them dismissively.
Ralph was much funnier than I was, and I have too many tickets here.
Oh, I don't think that's true, Pete. Stuff. You're very pedantic, and so you really.
You're both hilarious, but I didn't. If I wanted, I'm not bringing people on here to tell jokes. I want opinions about Star Wars.
I've listened to your show before. You're clearly not bringing people on it to tell jokes.
Exactly. Look, you know how many comedy podcasts there are? Oh, game funny. Trump impression this, drones that, but oh, comedy.
Dude, you're killing
so
me with
sick
this shit.
Of it. I know.
Drones.
Hold on, where's my headphones? There they are.
I was told there'd be no math.
I guess you can't count on his word.
I guess I can't.
While these guys are tallying up their tickets,
I really can't count because I just lost track.
I'm gonna thank you all for listening to Science Friction. Do me a favor, go on to iTunes and leave a review. It's pretty much the only way we get press at this point because I'm not allowed on social media until a certain thing is over.
I am not allowed to tweet. Be my tweets and be my Facebook posts and leave us a good review and share this episode and do all that stuff. You get bonus episodes for just a dollar at patreon.com/stereos. Why I did a, me and Sriracha, the moment we got out of Last Jedi, we did a review of The Last Jedi. All right. Pete the Retailer, how many tickets you got?
I did a rough estimate and it came out to 75.
Ralph.
Six.
Ralph, give me the real number!
I don't know, I wasn't counting. I can't count that high.
He was just looking at them. They're really fun to look at. They're all yellow on
it's,
one side.
I don't know, it was like 123.
Yes, I knew it. I knew you actually knew. Don't start with me. All right, so seeing as you got the good, the most tickets, Cake Boss Ralph is our winner. Cake Boss Ralph, well, actually, second prize goes to Pete the Retailer.
All right.
Pete the Retailer, you get this.
I'm number two.
Marvel Spider-Man pint-sized heroes. Blind bag, you could get Venom. You could get Spider-Man 2099.
Can I get the spot? Can I get Humbug? Can
no,
I get
the, oh. It's only Spider-Man's. There's no villains.
Spider-Man villain.
What about
really?
Paste Pod Pete?
You can't get Triple P.
That's my namesake.
You can't get Stilt Man. None of them. I'm going to toss this to you. Right. While you're opening it, give us your plugs.
My plug? Oh, yeah, I'm Pete the Retailer, at Pete the Retailer on Twitter. I host Star Wars Minute, which is StarWarsMinute.com, or at Star Wars Minute, or on Instagram at The Star Wars Minute. Long story. But yeah, find me there.
All right. Pop open that blind bag. Which Spidey did you get? Or Spy Genie?
Whoa, Peter Parker.
That's so cute.
And your namesake.
Peter Parker.
I was worried I wasn't going to get Paste Pot Pete because he's my namesake, but I got a Peter Parker. It all makes sense. The universe... Aww. The will of the force.
So Pete the Retailer picked a packet of Peter Parker.
Ooh, impressive. You should here, let's have some more tickets.
Exactly. Now they're worthless.
Any more tickets.
Man, Cake Boss Ralph, you're getting a Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2 Hero Clicks.
Oh,
it
Hero
contains
Clicks.
A pre-painted collectible miniature game piece. You could get Peter Quill, another Pete. Mm-hmm. You could get Baby Groot. You could get Rocket. You could get Drax, Gamora. On the back, it looks like that's pretty much all you can get is just one of the main guys.
Mantis? Can you get a Mantis?
No, Mantis is not on
Nobody
here. Even though
Mantis
is a member of the Guardians at this point.
I didn't see the second one, but I
don't see it. It's not great. While you're opening
it's
it,
fine.
Tell us, Gates, that's the thing. It's just fine. It's not great. While you're opening it, give us your plugs.
All right, so you can follow me on social media. I'm on Instagram and the Twitter. As Cake Boss Ralph, you can also, if you really want to see what it looks like when I'm at work, which is probably the most boring way to see anybody, you can watch the Cake Boss show on the television channel. I already have Baby Groot. Pete, do you want to switch?
Mine is called Peter, so I'm kind of... All
right.
You already have a Baby Groot Hero Clicks?
Yeah.
Do you play Hero Clicks?
No, but I do make impulse purchases.
I hear you. Okay. That's the guy kicking us out of the studio, so we gotta go. I'm Stereos Coconuts. Thank you so, so much. Y'all take care. Energize!
Thank you guys so much. We gotta get out of here before I get yelled at.